very privileged position this evening of having two distinguished visitors presenting. So I'd like to first of all introduce Professor Jinjun Zhu, who is the professor at Kunming Institute of Botany, the Chinese Academy of Sciences, and also a professor at the Institute of Animal Science, the Chinese Academy of Agricultural Sciences, and principal scientist at the World Agroforestry Center. Chen Zhu is a plant ecologist and ethnobotanist by trade, and he's been working on the integrated tree, crop, and livestock management systems coupled with social ecological systems in the Asian highland ecosystems. He has a very strong background in interdisciplinary research. Particularly his research highlights have been looking at warning signals of global change and examining ecosystem restoration, forest management, agroforestry, and the integration of trees, crops, and livestock into agro-systems. He has been researching for more than 30 years and has published over 150 papers in high-impact journals such as Nature and Science. So his current position is as chair of the Mountain Futures Initiative, which he's going to talk about now, which is also part of a global land program that promotes knowledge and innovation around smallholding farmers. Now, we also have a second speaker, Professor Richard Long. He's going to give the second half of the talk. Professor Long, he currently works as a senior ecologist and program coordinator of the Hindu Kush Karakoram Pamir Landscape Initiative. Sorry, my which is part of the International Centre for Integrated Mountain Development, which is based in Kathmandu, Nepal. Professor Long is also a university distinguished professor at Lanzhou University in Pastoral Science and Ecology. He's the founding director of the International Center for Tibetan Plateau Ecosystem Management and the director of the Engineering Research Center for Arid Agriculture and Ecological Rehabilitation for the Ministry of Education in China, another huge mouthful. So I think we're extremely lucky to be listening or hearing talks from these two extremely distinguished speakers today. So with that, I'll let them start.
Thanks, Andy. Give a bring us Chinese team here and my first trip to University of Bangor. And also today, the honor to share my experience working with mountains and to highlight why we should work with mountains. So today, my talk is called Mutualing Land System for Mountain Future. And we try to look at the innovation across seas, the seeds for change in Asia Highland. Basically, we talk a similar overlap with Professor Long, and they also yes, Himalayan region is very important. So before we start, and I have an additional introduction of what we'll do. And who I am, and so I call myself as an ethno-ecologist. We're really dealing with the complexity of the socio-ecological system. And that's where we, the so-called socio-ecological system is really started as a how people look at the world surrounding, the world view, and also what knowledge of different people we have. And then we talk about the Asian, the Chinese wisdom, also the West scientific knowledge. And also, we're also trying to look at the norm and the local intuition, and also the experiment innovation in both the locally and outside of what you're doing, and the teaching, learning. So everyone have our own way to learn, but also a lot of indigenous community have own way of teaching, learning, pass through generation across different community. And then finally also say how people classify the ecosystem and land, plants, and animals. So the taxonomy and typology is very important. boundary of research. And it's my talk, and then also my experience, and really experience a tremendous social transition. And I always say, you know, look at today's China, and my childhood, and we didn't have enough food, including myself. So what I manage, and you know, and then normally I have one dog, and then I have to manage, and as the oldest in the family, I have one younger brother, one younger sister, and but I have to take responsibility to manage, say, several rabbit, one goat, and two pigs, and then that means huge collection of fodder to feed the animal, and also I have to slaughter my dog to eat meat because that's you know the childhood and the thing that meat is very expensive and the thing very special and the thing if you don't slaughter your own dog it never will steam it. So you can see and I'm from East Coast area and then intense rice paddy and we have also the fish farm and we have mulberry and then vegetable garden a little bit and then so every year we have to close clean the fish pond and then make the organic fertilizer and then put into the paddy field. So in this system, nothing is waste. There's no waste, there's no pollution. And that's all the recycled in the ecological system in rural area and of China. And that's the how system work and not going to detail so the nutrient cycle within traditional farming systems in China is amazing. And who did you know discovering and the before my bone and this Franklin and a century ago he will document from outside the point of view why China have a huge population, how they manage with limited farming land feed more than 20% world population. So that's the secret with China with new limited land to support a huge population. But today, and a different story, and way now the China is the largest greenhouse gas emission and in the world, and we also face tremendous environment challenge, including the not only air pollution but also water, soil pollution, and through heavy metals, through the pesticide use. So the future generation of a farmer we're looking for, it's really we need to increase production and still meet the demands for meat and for food. We need to increase the below ground, above ground for carbon. This group also look up and also they reduce the emission, greenhouse gas emission. And we try to follow the French pathway. And if we can achieve the zero emission from agriculture, that would be miracle. And then also water stress is a huge, and we need to use less water, produce more food, and also we need to coping with the climate risk and build resilience for future. And the mountain are very important, and today my topic and my group is really also also going to have a forward looking to look at what's the future for mountain area, because the mountain and covered one fourth of Earth planet surface, but provide 40% ecosystem services and 60% fresh water for all mankind. And very important, you can see, and a lot of cultural diversity, biological hotspots are located in the mountain region, and also the huge deposit of mineral resources and other hydropower. So that's mountain critical ecosystem for everyone, including we are here. And why mountain matter? That's why, you know, so we needed to look at the origin of mountain and why mountain how ecosystem is evolving and why do we need care and which I mentioned and what we can learn from our ancestors and also where are we going? That's a critical question. Can we do business as usual to use extract natural resources from the mountain or not? And the mountain is active. It's a Himalaya is a tectonic between the Euro-Asia plate and also the India plate, so clash and then still and active and cause a lot of earthquake in recently in China and also in Pakistan and then Nepal. And the mountain, because this school also the geology study and nobody can ignore the mountain because mountain have a huge deposit for sediment from glacial organic sediment and also. So if you're going to study, understand our Earth planet, you have to study mountains. The mountain also always says the origin of a culture, and they and a lot of still practice shifting cultivation today, and that's the traditional farming system in the mountain. And this yak and the purpose that I'm going to talk about, and it's a very important origin, symbolic mountain, how to produce high quantity of products, but also reduce the emit much less methane than any carbon in the world. And mountains are connected and slopes the vegetation, the farming system. So everything you do in the top of mountain have an impact on lowland. So highland and lowland interaction are very important, and the connectivity of a mountain, and that's also we need to keep in mind. And the climate change, because the mountain is warmer, faster, higher than global average. And so climate change, which is shifted a tree line, the ecotone, which is a lot of discussion. So that also caused a lot of biodiversity loss, and some ecosystem will decline in the mountain region. And the mountain have multiple faces. And some people look at mountain as beautiful. Some people, and that's a painting by the Nazi people in Lijiang, Northwest Yunnan province. And I always like the art. And then if they are illustrated the mountain, that's basically also is a UNESCO heritage site. In here, it's a downstream thing. The glacial support, water running to the ancient town in Lijiang, that's a UNESCO heritage site. So then, you come different season in the different mountain to give different feeling of this. And the same, so utopia and also the cycle landscape and often we see some community practice, but also the mountain most often we look at the outsider at disaster and the risk of dangers because the landslide, flash floods cause death every year in the global mountain. That's the picture about Kabul, and then you can see the background of Hindu Kush, and also very important, and then Kabul, it's still a lot of social conflict and the poverty and the drug production area. And today, and still no solution for the mountain, some mountain region like Kabul. But the mountain very important for human. It's also inspiration. And the mountain gives you different feeling, like people sitting in the ocean, and a very simple ocean gives you a lot of different feeling. So similar to mountain, you can get a lot of richness of mountain. So now I'm back to the Asia mountains, and there's Asia mountains has largest cover in the global surface, and as one piece of the Tibetan Plateau, and also the Himalaya Hindu Kush area. And we have four global biotic spots in the Central Asia, Himalaya, South Mountains, Southwest China, Indo-Burma, all considered biological hotspots. And then it's overlap with a coexist high cultural diversity. So that's the we are dealing with. So cultural diversity, you can see from this map, the linguistic family, and then say along the foot hill of mountains, and they are very rich and very amazingly different. And there's a farming system, you can see it from again along the mountain, and also have high farming or global diversity. So key questions, why Asia mountain ecosystem supports large population, why Asia still have poverty, and why, what are the buffer people to dealing with social climate induced risk, what strategy or manage or nurture the mountain landscape for our next generation. So, in order to answer this question, and last year we have big gathering and from all over the mountain and region, Africa, Andes, and Asia. We talk about mountain, how we going to manage mountain or as main theme called neutral seeds for good and for thin. Because now you can see every year news about who climbed the mountain Everest. Now, even you are disabled people, you pay $160,000, people can carry you go to Mountain Everest top. So that's today's, you know, our capacity of human. You can go to Mountain Everest, you can see ocean. So human will control the earth plant net process. So that's what we're dealing with. So of course, among the future initiative, we try to look at some innovative way to dealing with the complexity and the face, also the challenge, and also that's what we call seeds for change. So basically, and of course, you can always climb the disaster poverty, but when we look at the indigenous community and they are forward looking, and that's why we call good Anthropocene. That our planner and our decision maker also have forward looking rather than downside. So we need to build our past traditional ecologic knowledge, look at the current institution and the action, and also to design what future need for our mountain region. So we have working group, and now we're looking for bright spots, the seed for change in the good Anthropocene. So the idea also, you know, the sustainable, we look at the evolution of the MDG or SDG now. So SDG today, we talk about biodiversity, ecosystem, climate change, and livelihoods. And so the vision, we try to look at a safe, just, and prosperous society, use neutrally and sustain diversity landscape in the mountain region, in which they are living, provide ecosystems, services such as water, energy, and food, and which is important locally, regionally, and globally. And so that's this we call seed cycle. And so we're looking for good seeds, some idea today, and some people, oh, your idea is stupid. But the idea is not stupid, but you have to neutrally the idea, put it into action for better behavior and also better the glowing up. So we call seeds, and then you get seedling seed tree, and then you get the reproduction cycle. That's like our forestry ecosystem, and we're looking at. So basically, we try to looking for disabled mountain future, which improves local livelihoods, ecological integrity, and social justice. So, and the seeds incubator strategy, and that's a combination of a bright spot, and if any idea we put into system, and but very important, we call innovation platform. That includes sustainable production, market integration, promotion, support environment, and also they analyze the seeds outcome. What you're doing, what outcome. And then finally, and we definitely what's called scaling up, upscaling, outscaling, and what you call. So it's really look at how we duplicate this kind of practice from one area to another. And so we really look at a transdisciplinary approach, and this we call seeds, and are understood in all dimensions: technical innovation, social economic institutional arrangement, analyzed with their own social ecological context, multi-stakeholder process, and are very important. And finally, includes inclusive plurality of knowledge system, value and vision for disabled future. So that's the three principles in the way we work on. So we try to look at action area. We're not include everything, and we look at biodiversity and sustainable ecosystem services. Agriculture system include production and the market value chain for food. And the rural urban migration and the urbanization are big trend in the mountain region. Climate change, both mitigation and adaptation. We focus three regions, Asia, Africa, Latin America as a top cover home underneath. So we call, we try to launch the 100 seeds and change. The seeds, which I mentioned, are initiated by current ESET, a protocol type, or still under some work underdeveloped, but could be bring about positive environment, social, and economic change. So that's, so seeds project will not only include technology innovation, but also the social change. So I try to give some example and about seeds project. So that's our always like painting, and then we work with the indigenous community in Southwest China, and we assign topic for them to illustrate through the art. That's one painting did by this housewife, and this whole painting include my book. You know. So they can see how richness the non-timber forest products get from the forest nearby. So mushroom, pine nuts, you know, so this the richness in what you're building, and that gives you your perception about how make forest better and rich, and then can support the local livelihood. And also, we also look at the tree-based solution, and that's, I'm not going to detail because, you know, we need to look at the agro-ecosystem. Agroforestry practice, and then how to combine genetic and also the later on the solution installation, and then you develop the enterprise. And that's the mining restoration. We use agroforestry and to restore the largest forest floor mining in Asia. That's one hour from my office, and then we have field demonstration you can see. And each piece will restore with a different combination. So use agroforestry for mining restoration in Kunming area. So restoration, and then we try to not only focus on structure, put species in place, but also how to support the function by combination of different species, timber, fruits, tea, oil, and the plant, flowers, and the spice, medicinal, and also mushroom are very important. And that's the process will restore the mining. And again, in mining side, you know, once tree have glowing with its high value, what's called the Ganoderma, is a medicinal plant, medicinal mushroom, and for high value market. And then also, the mushroom project in Mekong, and we actually have film, and I give copy to team, and you can distribute also. So, mushroom species is often neglected, and we have 3,000 macro fungi in Mekong, and then about 1,000 are edible, which produce more than $1 billion US dollar income to local livelihoods. But very keep in mind, and that's the mushroom distribution, high value mushroom distribution along the elevation gradings. But very important, when the succession of a forest, and also this succession of high valuable mushroom, and that's you know, the scientific knowledge and the interplay with local knowledge, and help local farmer to collect high value mushroom, or you manage restore the forest for mushroom, not for timber. So some mushroom were introduced to indoor, and then were put into lab for domestication, and this year and this week, and we just released 3 new species of mushroom, high valuable edible one to the market and into local cultivation. Recycle are very important, and often people are easy to throw away now. And we say in my childhood they say nothing waste, and today philosophy we can still say nothing waste. So basically, we use mining, agricultural residues, and the forest residues, and then also the mining gypsum and from mining area, we put it into a sausage machine, and we develop substrate to produce high quality seeding. So that's the, and also we develop new substrate for tissue culture, and that's without using any chemicals, and then you can put the mycorrhizal, and then you can develop, that's the what's called the pit. And that's more for high-value organic one, and then you can develop high quality substrate and for organic farming. So finally we combine the substrate and there was mycorrhizal and there was new different soil by microbials, and then develop a very dense and but also very fibrous roots mass and which can easily adapt to extremely condition. So that's we talk about. And then come back a little bit Asia and the Central Asia, we do agroforestry in Central Asia, and we do the ecological calendar, because with the climate change, traditional calendar doesn't apply anymore. The local knowledge you need to adapt, because they shift the tree line, shift the seasonality. So we need to invent, and we're doing invent of ecological calendar to particular action research, and finally we recalibrate the calendar, and that means and the later one anticipate the capacity for Indian people for warmer climate in the farming system also. So so that's what we did for Hunza in northern Pakistan, and that's some of my students and work with the local Indian committee, and also the urban food are very important, and can we transport sometimes not necessarily transport the food from far distance and cross continent, but how to produce food locally, even in urban setting. So we need to look at the urban food system. And so again, use different what's called a new technology. And then we also try to introduce this potato without dormancy. So anytime you harvest potatoes, a small potato, you put back to recycle the substrate and then growing. So that's the different species, and the Calotropis, and that's the species commonly distributed in semi-arid area in Africa and in China, in my region, and in Red River area, and that's Calotropis. And we develop high quality fiber from this one, and also we try to Denpai and I and my colleague also try to develop a nutritional fodder, and so it become multi-purpose species. And that's a Calotropis and nursery we developed. And finally, how we manage the landscape. And, so we have smart load planning in Mekong, and that collaboration was what's called a with Andrew Bamford from Cambridge University. Basically, we calculate any load pass through the environment sensitive area, what's the environment value, what's the agricultural potential, how to avoid the environmental impact, sometimes build a load can enhance the agricultural productivity. So that's we examine all load proposed in the region, and finally we see what load pass through the environment sensitive area. So you can see different countries have built different load in different different cause of environment, and also some have more high contribution to food productivity, but some is not. So again, you know, how to mitigate the load building risk, and how to enhance agricultural productivity. So that's when we're doing regional load planning, we need to keep in mind. So again, that's linked to Chinese investment in overseas, and when we plan any infrastructure, how we contribute to local livelihoods, sometimes minimize the environment cost. Finally, and that's another slide, and that's my team, and how we applied. Basically, we link with Chinese Academy of Agriculture in Beijing, but we're embedded with Chinese Academy of Sciences in Kunming. So that's my team, you can see, and we have, that's most administration. That's our scientists, that's our most PhD. So we have very good international team and different from different disciplines. And so that's, I try to stop here and I hand over to Mr. Long. Yeah. need to thank very much for the Laos government to provide this kind of financial support. My talk is a little bit narrow about because Professor Xu, who was talking about the Asian mountain, I would like to focus on the Qinghai Tibetan Plateau, and that is a very high area. And this nomadic livestock in has boundary on that highland area. Okay, I would like to, through my talk, maybe you can answer this four questions: where the yak come from, and what, why the yak be able to live in the highland. Also, what type of the relationship between yak and the Tibetan people. Also, the how to manage the nomadic livestock. To find that, how about this, to find a sustainable way. Okay, let's be quick for the journey to the Tibetan Plateau. Yes, here is Mongolia and is Tibetan and is India. So we can see from this map is with high area and high and dry is Kathmandu, Nepal and the Everest. And Everest, there's Lhasa, that's India. That's whole area we call it Qinghai Tibetan Plateau. Let me say where the yak come from. We say this is cattle, and we say yak, that's about 4 million years ago, yak was separate from the cattle. And another 2 million years later, it's a bison. They were also come from the yak. And for the yak, we see this wild yak. We also have the domestic yak. Notice this, that's the domesticated about 8,000 to 12,000 years ago. That's domestic yak. And notice the yak is distributed in the whole area, about more than 10 countries in that Hindu Kush, Himalaya. And the total population about 15 million, but only in China we have about 90% of the we can find in China in the Qinghai Tibetan Plateau. Then if we see this Qinghai Tibetan Plateau from the satellite, that's India, and we will see from the north to the south is higher of the rainfall and more is high, yes. The rainfall is more and the elevation is high from the north to south. And also from the east to west, that's also this low and this area is high. So rainfall is less. That means this area is high but dry. What is the nature? You can see it's about 2.5 million square kilometers in that area, about one fourth of the Chinese total area. And also the highest, the average is 4,000 meters high in that entire plateau. So we call it the third pole. We have north pole, south pole, we call the third pole. And also the rangeland in that area is covered about 50% of the rangeland. And also the climate is cold and dry. This is the Tibetan Plateau, some the nature and the yak and the sheep and the river and the tents, Tibetan, so that's the ecosystem. Because these are too high, they cannot do any agriculture. So the only way that area can be used is for the livestock, the grazing all the year round. Let's see why the yak who adapt that can live in that area. We say we have north pole and south pole. Here is it, we call it Tibetan Plateau, we call this the third pole. And in the north pole, they have the polar bear. In the south pole, they have penguin. In the third pole, they have yak. And we know this bear, they need to hold fat and long, maybe sleep. They need to adapt. And here also, they hold a lot of fat. But why is yak? Why they can live over there? Okay, what is how does this yak adapt to this open harsh environment? Is it first they low oxygen,
And you see, from 3,000 meters to 5,000 meters, only above 70 to 45% of the sea level, here in sea level almost. And the cold in the winter is very cold, minus 40, even low. And also the insufficient forage they can provide from the natural pasture through a year, particularly during the winter. Okay, then they adapt to this low oxygen by the yak. They say they can do some rising, it's very quick. Also this, they carry all the goods to the Himalaya, to the Everest. That because they have the large heart and large lung. And also this is a particular cell for the human only when the baby and before, yes. But for the yak, they can hold life. They have this kind of special cell that can carry much of the oxygen in the body. And how does it, if contrast of the cattle, the yak have that thick layer of the fat, that this the skin and the skin that are fat, and with up to functional sweat or sweat glands. And also the long hair and down hair and also on the back. So this is very, they cover whole the body. And also during the winter, look at that, they're covered by the snow, but they still have some very, the nature of the adapt that cold area. And also if they contract the cattle, yak have the shorter tongue, if the same body size. And also this, so that's lead to the yak, intake behavior is quite different from cattle. They like the sheep, use the leap, use the leaps, and very quick, and they use very short grass they can have in. You see here is a very short, almost no grass, but yaks too can have some food. And also the yak tongue is shorter. And also the weak taste, the taste from the tongue is very weak, so they can select the broad of the eating and species, more species, but like the cattle. Cattle is very sensitive to select some concentrate under the grass. But the yak, they can much broad. That's because, yeah, its tongue is some special. And regarding the rumen, stomach, we are talking about rumen in the mountain. And yak also have the large rumen. They can consume greater or more of the food, of particularly for the low quality. They can eat more, and then they can longer for the fermentation in the yak rumen, and to get more nutrients. Also, the yak from the rumen, they produce much less of the missing and more and volatile fat acid. That's from the rumen. We work with the genomic of the in the rumen macro. Okay, this is we published this paper, and we found this cattle and this yak and the sheep, the Tibetan sheep, also another ruminant, smaller ruminants. They are almost native. So the yak, they go this way. They have the highlight of the genes in the produce high VFA and low and high missing, low VFA. But for the cattle, but for the yak and the Tibetan sheep, they produce higher VFA and the low missing. That we say yak is a low carbon animal. So here we also use the in vitro. From the genetic base, we found the evidence, and for the in vitro, we also found the similar evidence. That means the yak produce much less of the VFA and the high VFA and the low missing. And also the yak, they can more sufficiently to use the nitrogen. If they intake the same diet with a different level, if compare cattle, the yak they can, in the lower quality, lower and the quantity, they can have high of the retention nitrogen in the body tissues. That yak can do. But for the cattle, they from the start very lower, there's almost nothing, and gradually it can increase. But yak from very lower. But when the environment and the feed is enough, is sufficient, then the yak and the cattle almost same. But for the horse, the yak can produce can is much better. That also we find some genes and different this nitrogen energy and the low oxygen. That's five. We found five genes from the genomic research. That's also our group. We've done this work. Okay, the key message. Once yak is from genetic and physiology, I will adapt to the high altitude. And also the yak is nitrogen saving animal, and the yak is a low carbon animal. That's so far we found some very good of the evidence. That's okay, what type of the relationship between yak and the tapetans? We can see that the case were carried by the yak during their nomadic journey. If we go to the domestication, in the 7,000 to 7,000 years ago, from the genetic, we published this in the Nature Communication. Another group from Lanzhou University, they published this in Science. We just put the two papers and come together. We found it's what is the domestication of the yak related to the people, the human expectation. We found in the about 7,000 years, they have first population for the human in that area gets larger and to expansion. And the second time we found it is about 3,000 years. The second time this population expansion. That's also this domestication and quite faster. So we see this the time and they match each other. And also in this 3,000 years also they match each other. So we see the yak domestication and they're very related to the human in that area expansion. So nowadays in Tibetan Plateau we have about 10 million people and also about 40 million of yak. And today nowadays with the yak are the Tibetan family members. They are very relying on of the yak. You see this, and the people lay down, and the girls, and the milk, and the girls, and also they look after the yak. It's as a member. And also this yak, they can produce about 90% of the drink milk that is demanded by the local herders. And also about 60% for the meat, because another 40 will be provided by the sheep and the goats. For the vitamins, and yesterday I said the yak who live or not, the Tibetans who live about 5,000 meters high, but without, for example, 4 months or half year, they cannot access any vegetable. But they drink the yak milk. Yak milk can sufficient to provide that vitamins, including vitamin A and vitamin E and vitamin C. That they are living in the heat in that heart without and fresh vegetable. Also a lot of minerals. So the yak, the meat, and they make some butter, this butter tea. Also this here you can see some meat and the dry meat. Yes, I grow some meat and here is yak meat. And also this butter and this is for the dry cheese. The dry cheese, they just sun dry of cheese in the outside. Or this yogurt is very dense yogurt. Okay, the transportation and the prawn. This is transportation and also this and prawn and also this in the Tibetan area, even the soldier also they rent the yacht for the petrol and they go to the border. And also the ladies and transportation. And you see this Everest here is from south side of the Himalaya and how the people this is the first base camp to climb Himalaya about 5,000 meters. So all the yak and can climb back up and to the yak cannot get here, but they can carry the goods and everything to this area here. Because the yak carried and everything for the people who are prepared to climb up. And also, I think it's in UK. And this very good, and there's two big yak, and they carry two persons as a small right? Okay, regarding the yak dung, yak feces, also that unique field for the local people. They can collection, and dry against the wall, and the face, and the home, house, also the storage. The cooking in the tents, also cooking food. Also, even sometimes if you have this very taste of bread, then just to cook the burning of the yak dung, and when they finish, they bread. That's okay. You can taste and quite good. Also, the fiber and skin. You see, that's the people, the Tibetan, and they just use the fiber and to work up to the tents and others. And for the skin, they just the cross of the river, and they use a lot in the past years. Also, this yak fur and the people, the lady, just on the back, as another of the the good thing. And also the people, and they threw a stone, also use the yak fiber to do some and to throw away of their stones. Also for the religions and the art, also the butter lamb, and this butter flower, and also this very important elements in the Tibetan Buddha's religion, also some arts. So that's this yak, who we call sometimes is holy yak. The herders, they need to select at least one, the best yak. They never touch, just let them naturally go. And they cannot kill, and they just, that's it with this kind of things, and to decorate, and they just let them naturally go. Also, another for the nomadic, they have the polo, the yak polo, the particular in the Chatara of the and Mongolia and Pakistan. Yes, last time I was there. And also for the bush cage, they just use the yak skin, and the four people, six people come together to cohabitate in the also in Xinjiang, in that area. Also the yak rice and in Tibetan a lot, and this yak dancing a lot, and have others. So I just take this four of them. And also this guy, and how to catch of the yak. And they have to follow and use the rope, and then it's very good technique, you can call yak cowboy. Nomadic life is harsh, but they still enjoy, because that's the men, and that time, this is a lady who carry everything. It's a baby, you can hear, it's a baby. The baby on the top, and he's a chicken. Yeah. This is a big case, and followed by some sheep. That's nomadic and quite harsh. And also they just get raised and outside. Also the inside of the tents is not that rich, and also look at this. It's very little. It's not from the Tibetan, but it's from the nomadic people. They are just directly to good, yes, it's very little. So nowadays, and we already, and very we still keep very less of the nomadic, but in the whole Tibetan plateau, we are have the settled, same settled, we call the transhumans, and the seasonal transhumans. They have that. So during the under this kind of a system, the local herders, they divided the pasture as a supreme pasture. This is this supreme pasture, almost no grass, very, very short, very less, there's no grass. And this summer pasture. summer pasture, they can go to the mountain and to the shrubland a lot, and to grazing in the shrubland on the forestry. Also, they go to the high mountain, another, and this pure rangeland. And this autumn pasture. This autumn pasture, they have some animals, and most animals in the mountain. Also, this winter pasture. That's transhumans nowadays, and to through the same setup. So they do this kind of ecosystem and livestock animal husbandry. Okay, that during this kind of system, they have very good the summer camp. They have car and it's a big car and big car and smaller car. They also have the big camps, and this with the solar energy and the video and this television, and also this. That's in the summer pasture, because summer pasture, they just live there for the maximum for 2 months. They just sit up the tents and also even this kind of a permanent house. And the people enjoy, and this beautiful girl over there. And also the people, they have many, and they can do this kind of pray from the long distance to Lhasa. Sometimes they need, they cost a half year, 6 months, because each step they need to knees and this. One by one. And also it's very harmony life. You see this is a wildlife and mammals, and this is lady, and they are treat each other, it seems very harmony. Okay, now this winter settled house, that's a permanent house, and this they have green, we call some kind of the greenhouse, and to keep during the winter very hot, they keep the livestock inside. And they have a lot of hay, and this yak dung, and this they are the human in this inside. Also the yak during early morning, they just get milking, and the people eat inside there. This is nowadays for the winter of the set of what we call the permanent house. And in summer, they go to the high mountain, use the tents. Okay, some key message. As a yak is a multi-purpose animal and provide necessary everything for the herders, and food and shelter, fuel, transportation, even the social status. If you have more yak, your very social status very high. Without the yak, you'll get very poor. Nobody would like to talk to you. And you have to leave. That's why a lot of people, they leave and go to the city to find some job. And at least over their rangeland to neighbors. Also the meat and the SGU is functional food for the maintaining the nomadic health. Also the yak is not only a species maintaining rangeland ecosystem, also is a key element in the Tibetan culture. And during the early time, the yak population expanded, the human population expanded, but the heavy relying on the yak domestication in the Tibetan plateau. Also with yak and the capacity to live in that highland, the human civilization may not have established in that remote area. So that's why the 10th Panchen Lama said that if no yak, would not be the people. The Panchen Lama, the who is position is equal to the Dalai Lama. And how we can manage transhumans and the nomadic and this way in a sustainable way. So this, how we can do this? And we see what the challenge nowadays in that particular area. If we see the last 100 years, in the global average, and the temperature increase about 0.6 in the last 50 years. in the last 50 years. But in the Tibetan and HCAP and the Hindu Kush, Himalaya, that area, that's increased during the last 50 years only, about 1.5 degrees. That's 2 times or 3 times. Yes, that's why we are facing this kind of challenge, the global warming. But that area is really sensitive to the global warming because it's glaciers and others. So another is for the rangeland degradation we are facing. Now this degradation open meadow in the headwater of the Yellow River. And plus overgrazing, plus is climate change. That's an area about over 4,000 meters high. And nowadays some area has become very degraded. And now you said even during the summer, there's no grass. And the grass cannot grow. And also, if it comes across, this is also another pressure to that area. So we see these opportunities, and maybe if we see this ecosystem, particularly for the rangeland Tibetan, and the biological structures for the Tibetan rangeland, and they have plant, soil, microbe, and also animals. And this is, I said this 50 years ago, or more than 50 years ago, is William Davis from the IGA, from the Grassland Environment Research Institute of Wales. Now it's already been emerged to the university. Who addressed this structure, plant and microbe and animals? They said plant is producer, and animals consumer, and the microbe in the soil is a decomposer. So nowadays we say we must put the herders there, who is a manager of this kind of ecosystem. Otherwise, if we are ignorant of the herder, they cannot do anything long sustainable. That's difficult. Particularly, we are facing global change. Now, we said that the rangeland ecosystem, that basically they can have ecological function and production function, livelihood function. But in China, in Tibetan Plateau, we are still have this challenge. The people who are take care much about the animal, that's how they saw many of animals. They not take care much of the environment function or ecological function, because they can, from the production function, from livestock, they can get direct income. But in some area, in the long term, this livelihood function will be declined. If there's no grass and how this animal can exist, then we have to move. We have to become the ecological refugee. They go somewhere. Okay, so we build this kind of model. We say the functional production, if, for example, you have 100 hectares of the rangeland, maybe you need to support 10 yak. And this 10 yak, they can support one people, one Tibetan. This kind of a model is ideal. But notice sometimes this part is too big, and this part is a bankrupt. And this and the long term is not much of the production. So we see this, the basic part is ecological services. Ecological services. And in the middle is economical, from they can get income and from the animal. Also, the on the top is the social. So this three parts how to combine together is coped with the nature and the social. That's the ecosystem we need. So we call it a functional integrated management model. Yes, we hope this kind of they can contribute a little bit how the management of that highland area. For the research, we are focused on today is the rangeland ecosystem. They have the animal, soil, and vegetation interaction, this interface, this interaction with each other. So how we can understand the different border and C and B and A, and we need to focus on how this interaction. But, and here we see under the global change and the climate change, we see the herder always need to be in the center to be take care. Then could we have some sustainable development of Tibetan pastoralism in the future come? So the summary, the last one. We see nowadays the lifestyle, the Tibetan lifestyle has been changed from nomadic to the transhumans. That's already changed and in most of the area. Another is the production pattern also changed. It's from the collective farm, the big farm and collective. Now this household farm. Under this household farm, but because before this collective, they have very smart and it's not smart, but they are working together. That's okay. But nowadays, if not smart farm, they get poor. The smart one, they get very good and for the production. Also, the function of the Qinghai Tibetan Plateau's ecosystem function also get changed. Nowadays, we see from the national livestock production base, the province, we from that high land area, we need to produce more products, meat and milk. That's why there's high pressure for the own reason. And notice we should provide ecosystem services to the China. Now this function also changed. So under the climate change, we need to see, we need to take a multidisciplinary and innovation approach to ecosystem thinking, how to thinking and the idea and the concept. And I much needed to plan and management this Qinghai Tibetan Plateau ecosystem, as in particular facing nature and the human challenge, so much challenge in that area. Okay.